When people in the past came across the fossilized bones of large vanished animals, it begged any number of questions. What sort of creatures could they possibly have come from? How old were these skeletal remains? Above all, perhaps, what did they mean?
Just like us, ancient peoples were fascinated by the giant bones they found in the ground. Like us, they obsessed about their origins. In this program, I'm going to explore the ways in which our ancestors sought to make sense of the remains of dinosaurs and other giant prehistoric creatures, and how they tried to reconcile such finds with their own understanding of life on Earth. That these explanations were wrong doesn't mean that they deserve our contempt. Just the opposite.
Science begins in wonder and a yearning to fathom what may at first seem unfathomable. In that sense, at any rate, our ancestors did have something of the paleontologist about them. And in one fundamental respect, they were absolutely spot on. Monsters had indeed once trodden the earth.
When cavemen came across the bones of dinosaurs, what did they make of them? It's an abiding mystery. By definition, they wrote nothing down. But there were some prehistoric peoples, for all that, who survived into historic times. Take North America, for instance, where hunter-gatherer tribes that for generations had been roaming the Great Plains had long observed fossilized bones weathering out of the rocks and invented stories to explain them. Adrian Mayer is a historian of ancient fossil hunting, with a high regard for the scientific abilities of the native peoples who lived in America before Columbus, peoples who, by and large, were pre-literate, prehistoric.
Their theories and their speculations and their myths, oral traditions, preserved in oral traditions over generations, over thousands of years, they were based on observation over time. They knew anatomy, they compared, they tried to imagine the creatures while alive, how they behaved, what they looked like, what kind of habitat. They actually had a sense of deep time. They had a sense of different ages on the earth, past ages before the appearance of present-day humans. Each age characterized by different fauna and flora, different landforms. These are all prototypes of modern science, although they were all in mythological language.
Even in the 19th century, by which point bone hunting or paleontology had become an all-American obsession, these Stone Age myths were still being retold. Many of the dinosaurs in the Peabody were dug up in the 1870s, a time when the West really was very wild. Among the collection are the first specimens ever found of iconic species, like Stegosaurus and Apatosaurus, the dinosaur formerly known as Brontosaurus. Marsh's expeditions took him to the Badlands. There, in his hunt for fossils, he was drawing on the very latest in scientific research. But some of his sources were altogether more prehistoric.
The Sioux and other Native American peoples, too, told stories of mysterious beasts, supernatural creatures, whose bones might be found scattered across the ground. But what had prompted these legends?
From the Sioux, Marsh learned the legend of thunder horses, creatures that galloped over storm clouds and made them echo with the crashing of their hooves. His fascination with such stories helped to win him the trust of Native Americans. In 1874, at a time of great tension, when the whites were encroaching on their lands, Marsh was able to employ a Sioux as his guide. He learned about some impressive bones found by the tribe. They said they were from strange creatures that had once lived in the land of the Sioux, bones now turned to stone.
Marsh was shown the bones of this magnificent beast, a colossal mammal some 12 feet long, which had lived around 35 million years ago, and was indeed, amazingly enough, a relative of the horse. This is the very specimen that was shown to Marsh, and in honour of the legends of the thunder horse told him by the Sioux, he named the creature a brontotherium, a thunder beast.
Most intriguing of all, perhaps, were the tales told across the Great Plains, not of thunder horses, but of thunder birds. Stories passed down the generations and still retold today.
Long, long ago, when the two-leggeds were new to walking on Mother Earth, the Thunderbirds were their friends and advisors. They were great beasts, with wingspans as long as two war canoes. They had sharp pointed beaks with sharp pointed teeth, and they lived in the sky, on the edge of the clouds.
Many of these legends tell how the Thunderbirds had, as their deadliest enemies, giant aquatic monsters.
Now at this same time lived the water monsters. They were huge, shaped like a snake, with feet. They had a big horn on their head and spikes on the tip of their tail.
It's surely suggestive that the stories often derive from regions of America which once, back in the age of the dinosaurs, were indeed covered by seas. Nowadays, the Great Plains consist of weathered sediment, complete with the skeletons of long-necked marine reptiles called plesiosaurs and pterosaurs, flying reptiles of the kind that were always carrying off Raquel Welch. And what do we find in Marsh's collection? A plesiosaur and a pterosaur, a pteranodon. What all this suggests is an intriguing possibility.
Almost all of the tribes had stories about water monsters and sky creatures, thunderbirds. And of course, these are personify violent forces of nature. Thunder and lightning, very powerful forces of nature. And then flooding, which was supposedly caused by water monsters. And when they found very large bones, fossilized bones of extinct creatures eroding and weathering out of riverbanks and lake shores, they naturally thought that they must have been water creatures. And then when they also found fossilized shells and fish and turtles, they understood that this land had once been underwater.